Welcome to this 2024 webinar about renewable sources. My name is Simone Pedrazzi. I'm assistant professor on thermodynamics and heat transport at the University of Modena and Reggio Emilia, Department of Engineering Enzo Ferrari. This is my email, my contacts. This is the website of my group where we post several researches. So if you want any information from our group, you can contact me wherever you want. Today, present work concerning the gasification of biomasses. In particular, we will study the environmental boundary condition on this thermochemical reaction. As you know, probably you know that the gasification is a thermochemical reaction that converts biomass in syngas fuel. It's a fuel, gaseous fuel that will be used to produce electricity. And then thermal power. However, all the plants that working in the world are affected several constraints. In particular, biomass characteristic is the more influenced, more is the major influencer on the classification behavior. However, also environmental conditions, so environmental conditions like air, ambient air temperature, relative moisture of the air can affect the working, the running of the of this kind of plant. One minute, I want to present my group. The group is placed in Modena, in the north of Italy, and the name of the laboratory is BILAB, Bioenergy Efficiency Laboratory. And what we are working so far, working on so far from 2010, is focused on almost on gasification with both experimental trials and modeling effort. But in the last years, we are also focusing on the application of biochar. Biochar is a byproduct from gasification. We will talk in later about biochar, applied on agricultural soil, so on agriculture, in order to improve the biomass productivity and to save water and to increase the fertilization of the soil. So the biochar is a well-known amendment that is very good for soil application. So the point is use the agricultural residues or forest residues in order to produce the energy for the plant, for the farm, and use the biochar obtained from the gasification for amendment application. So in this way we can close the circularity of the farm. So we are talking about circular economy applied to agriculture. The team is composed of engineers, of course, and biologists. Biologists are working soil quality evaluation and also carbon capture sequestration possibility. So we are a group of about 10 persons now, and we believe in the carbon in a sustainable no carbon future. In our region, this is where a plan, this plan is called Po Valley. The Po Valley comprehends a lot of cities. In particular, you have Bologna, is the biggest, but we are near Bologna, we are in Modena. Modena, probably you know Modena for Ferrari. But we don't have only sports car, but we have a lot of biomass residues and sources. For example, this area is full of river, so we have a lot of biomass from river maintenance. So, for example, from one small, we have a project, we did the project in the past concerning the biomass valorization of a relatively small river near our department. In this case, we obtained about 50 tons of wet biomass for about 1 kilometer of river length near the river bank. So the amount of that of this biomass is huge. But we don't have only river, we have all like in all Italy wine production, so we have about 50,000 hectare of vineyards. Each hectare produce about 3 tons of wet prunings every year. So another big biomass possibility. We have forest on the south of our city, where is the mountains called Apennines, Appennini, and here where is there are forests, and the maintenance of this forest creates every year tons and tons of biomass residues. So this is another point of collection of biomass. But another big agricultural production in our region is related to the hemp for fiber. In the past, we are the greatest hemp fiber producer all over the world. So now the situation is changed. We have some farm that produce almost biomass for CBD extraction, but our region is particularly indicated for growing hemp for the climate condition. So we have also a lot of agricultural residues, not only from hemp, but also from stalks, from corn, sorghum. A lot of biomass in our region. During our research. We study the gasification project using several process, using several biomass gasifiers. Now, this is the most recent biomass gasifier that we are using in our laboratory. From 2016, we work together with a California-based company called All Power Labs, and we are working to improve its gasification facility that is called PV30 gasifier. So at the moment we are working in the filtration and also in the engine characterization, and byproducts adaptation, because now this gasifier is working on, especially on wood chips and corn cobs. Now we are able to work also with pellet, and in particular with several kind of pellet, vine pruning pellet, hemp, hard pellet, for example, and also wood pellet from wood residues. So we are converting this machine in order to work with pellet from residues. But this is not only the unique gasifier we have in the lab. We have another two gasifier. The first that we built in the past is called a Femto. This is a very small tabletop gasifier, and with a nominal biomass consumption of about 1 kilogram per hour. And we tested in the past a lot of residues with this gasifier, because it's small, so it's very easy to maintain, to open, to operate, so in a few reach stable state condition. So the first run with new biomass sources was performed with this kind of gasifier. But we design and run also pyrolyzer. In this case, a small scale reactor pyrolyzer for pyrolyzation of especially for stalks and also for pyrolyzation of leaves of green waste material. In this case, in this picture, we use hot exhaust gas from the PP30 gasifier to pyrolyze stalks. So in this way, we have in this vessel we obtain pyrolyzed carbonized material, and the gas, the pyrolysis gas, was used directly in the gasification unit. So let's go straight to the talk of today. Few words about gasification. As you know, the gasification is the conversion of that is not only biomass, but also waste of all organic material that have carbon inside, can be converted in a gas, can be gasified. And this is the combustion of a stick. And in this case, the in the first phase, there is the combustion of the fuel on the top of the stick, but after this this first passage, we have a continuous gasification during the stick combustion because thanks to high temperature the stick is carbonized, so we convert the stick in char. During this process, the pyrolysis gas is converted. It's burned because there is the flame starting from the beginning. So, and there is a luminous light that is made by the pyrolysis gas burning. And the more orange color trace is made by the combustion product, so carbon monoxide, water vapor, and other exhaust products. So in this way, also in this stick, we did gasification, but the syngas is burned directly on the stick itself. If you want to extract the gas from gasification reaction, we need to do some stages. And this is the energy balance of a gasification when it explains all the stages that are present in the gasification reactor. First of all, there is the drying, or first of all, sorry, the energy input is entering the reactor, the energy entering the reactor through the biomass and through the gasification medium, normally is air or CO2 or steam or oxygen, depends on the gasifier. So after the first drying stage, that is performed using energy directly from the external sources or from the internal sources, depend of the type of the gasifier, there is the pyrolysis, where heat is given to the gasifier and create pyrolysis gases and carbon char. There's the combustion where the pyrolysis gas are burning and then produce CO2 and H2O, so carbon monoxide and water vapor. And then finally, there is the gasification reactor where carbon produced by the pyrolysis, so the carbonized material, reacts with the combustion process products to create syngas fuel. The syngas goes out. This case is called product gas, is the correct name when we use biomass as sources, and also the char is extracted, then converted char is extracted from the bottom of the gasifier. However, we lost a part of energy from the reactor because the reactor is hot and exchange heat from the wall to the ambient air by convection. We can reduce this using isolating material, but we can nullify because we need a lot of insulating to reduce the the thermal dissipation, so the economic, from the economical point of view, is not suitable to over insulate the gasifier. The energy to sustain the reaction is given by the combustion stage, so the energy is used from combustion, used for the gasification because the gasification is slightly endothermic, but is used almost for pyrolysis and drying. These two processes are high endothermic, so they need a lot of heat to go ahead. Passing from the theory to the practice, so how are made this kind of gasifier? There are a lot of architecture of gasification. In this presentation, we focused on the P30 reactor, and in this case, as you know, as you see in the picture, this is the section of the gasification reactor. All the passages that I mentioned before are present, the drying process, the pyrolysis, the combustion, the reduction, and the gas use is filtered in the cyclone and used to drying indirectly the biomass itself, and then use in a engine. In this part of the slide, there is an explanation of all the conversion and the reaction that take place in the gasifier. What I want to focus the temperature, the peak temperature that is reached inside the gasification is about from 800 to 1200. In this case, higher is the temperature, higher is the cracking of the tar. During the pyrolysis, we produce a lot of tar gases that are very dangerous if this tar cool down and reach the engine, creates a lot of problem of on the mechanical component of the engine. So this kind of gasifier, the common way to reduce the tar output is to have a very hot tar cracking zone, in particular the combustion hearth, I'm just calling this slide, where the temperature reaches so high value to convert the tar cracking, the tar by temperature. Not all the tar are converted because because the reaction is not always well balanced, and there is some preferential pathway of the air and also of the tar gases inside the reactor. So a little bit of them pass through and goes in the output, and we need a filter before the engine to separate them to reduce the risk to damage the engine. Very, very fast, I will explain the modeling approach. In this case, we use a 0D equilibrium approach, where there is the gasification reaction. It's a reaction where we have the general formula of biomass, and this is the output fire, so the Single output, hydrogen, CO, CO2, water, methane, tar and char. Char is the char that is extracted from the bottom, is the not used char. This model calculated, depending on the temperature, the tar weight fraction and also the carbon conversion factor. And the X, Y and Z coefficient are calculated from the characterization of the biomass, so from the elemental analysis of the biomass. The factor W is calculated using ash content and moisture M of the biomass, e instead the M factor is calculated knowing the equivalence ratio of the reaction. So the equivalence ratio is the actual oxygen used for gasification subdivided by the total oxygen needed for the complete combustion. This value in gasification is about 0.3, more or less. So we can, from the previous reaction, we can write this chemical balance, and also we can write this heat balance, knowing the heat of formation of every single component, reactive component and product component. So the algorithm that is used to solve the equation is this one, starting from the ultimate analysis of the biomass at temperature, average temperature of the first of first tentative, so the temperature that is used to start the calculation, but not the final temperature, and the equivalence ratio. Solving the previous balance, we can so first of all, using the temperature that is the first approximation, we can calculate the equilibrium constant, the carbon factor and the tar conversion, and then from Newton-Raphson approach we can calculate the chemical amount and the heat from the heat amount from the chemical a composition of the exhaust of the product gas, we can recalculate using the heat balance the new temperature. So if the temperature is similar to the first temperature, tentative temperature, then we can calculate the final this temperature is the final one, the average final one temperature of gasification, and then with other calculation we can extract the calorific value of the gas, the content of the tar, and the efficiency of the gasification. If the temperature is lower or higher than the previous one, there is another cycle of calculation. To this model, we add the influence of the relative moisture of the air, and also we simulate several air temperature boundary condition. This is the equation that derived from psychrometry that we use to correlate the relative moisture on the air to the and the temperature for the calculation to the double view air, so the amount of the specific amount of water vapor in the air that is used in the general gasification reaction. We take into account also the heat losses from the walls of the gasifier, considering natural convection, so convection. So we did a dimensional study using Nusselt number and calculating the Rayleigh number, Prandtl number of the air, and we hypothesized the shape of the gasifier like a cylinder with a diameter D and a height L. Oh, and then using Nusselt, we calculate the H coefficient of convection and the thermal power dissipated and the specific thermal power dissipated, dividing the thermal power for the molar mass of biomass, molar mass flow of biomass that is converted inside the reactor. This is the first result from the simulation. In this graph, you can see the influence of ambient air temperature and air relative moisture on the gasification efficiency. And you can see that lower is the temperature of the air, lower is the conversion efficiency of the gasifier, and also there is a slightly decrease also with an increase of the relative moisture of the air. This because we add water on the gasification reactor, and this decreases the reaction. This simulation was made using fir wood pellets as biomass with 8% of moisture, with an equivalence ratio of 0.3, and considering a gasification wall temperature of about 150 degrees Celsius. This is the tau amount exiting from the reactor in gram of divided normal cubic meter. Higher is the tau, lower is the efficiency of the gasifier. In this graph, we can see that again the temperature influences the tar amount, the air temperature. higher is the ambient air temperature, lower is the tar exit from the reactor, and also increasing the relative moisture of the air. There is a little increase of the tar generated. This is given because the same talk of that I made previously. So we add the water that decrease the general gasification performance. In this graph, we show the single water vapor dew point. So, higher is the temperature of the air, lower is the dew point, and also In this case, there is a lot of a strong dependence of the relative moisture of the air on the Syngas dew point. The Syngas dew point, water vapor dew point, is the temperature below them there is a condensation of water vapor inside the Syngas stream. This water vapor is a sort of nucleation point when it converted from vapor to liquid is preferred water the nucleation point for tar. So if there is a lot of droplets of water inside the streams, in these droplets there is the creation also of tar agglomeration. So this is the reason why we don't want to go under the dew point of the gas if you don't want to create problem on the filter or engine particular. However, as you see in this graph correlates the Syngas gasification, the reactor efficiency on the biomass moisture and on the equivalence ratio. So the equivalence ratio should affect the efficiency value, and the maximum efficiency value is for ER 0.3, as you expected. Also, the biomass moisture decreases a lot the Syngas efficiency. This is because increasing the biomass moisture, we add another point of water inside the system, and the water decreases the temperature and the efficiency. Unbalance the reactor and the efficiency of the reactor itself. Concluding, we found with this paper that the air ambient temperature is a key parameter for biomass gasification, and as shown in the previous graph, higher is the air temperature, higher is the gasification efficiency. Relative moisture don't affect so much tar and tar production and Syngas gasification efficiency, but affect a little bit the tar dew point of the Syngas. Also, air temperature influence this Syngas tar dew point. However, biomass moisture and equivalence ratio have a greater influence on the gasification compared to with the boundary conditions. So again, the biomass moisture need to be lower as possible, and if you want a good gasification condition, we prefer to have a high ambient temperature with low relative moisture. This is characteristic of, for example, dry zone like north of Africa, the desert zone where there is during the day high temperature and low relative moisture. Thank you for your attention. I finished my presentation. Sorry for take 5 or 10 minutes more than expected. Thank you so much. Have a good day.